And then, you know, we're going to jump into the energy from the open ceremony. It was such a beautiful introduction to the third year of this amazing three-day festival. And today's February 3rd. That's a lot of threes. I think that's special, right? So I think Chris said something this morning. He said about taking the wheel of the ancestral ship and guiding it towards the light. And I thought that was really poetic and beautiful. And the process I'm going to share to you today hopefully will give you some tools so you can do that. Steer that ancestral ship towards the light. And when I was, after the ceremony, I was looking over at Green Lake and just the beautiful stillness and reflection of this magnificent green wall that protrudes up into the sky that's reflected on this lake. And I, you know, and I felt the energy of the awareness of when the water is still is when we can, you know, we can receive and we reconflect our higher selves and we can have more insight. When the water gets a little bit rippled or chaotic, sometimes it might be harder to tell the exact reflection. So I'm just gonna trust that we're jumping in here. Everybody's done their practice or their personal routine in the morning and they're dropping into some still energy so they can receive this. Because I think this is some powerful stuff. I've been working and living in the tropics for some time, activating people that are sometimes needing a little encouragement. And where that came from was I went to school for design. I had a professor, a whole systems designer, tell me about this process, right? How to take something from an idea to a reality. And it blew my mind. It was like magic, right? Like the fact that there's these clear linear steps to do that. And so right after school, I worked with community arts, and I saw that some of these aspects of this process we were using to engage community to create artistic enhancements and gardens and things like that. And then I adapted it, right? So this crazy design process that can sometimes feel really overwhelming, what I've done is streamlined it in a way that I hope that it's accessible and easy to engage with. So you can take any idea from the download or the crucible of it and bring it into realization, right? And so after design school, I worked in a nonprofit realm with kids in social services, and I saw again how this process that I learned after being simplified to the community, how it could be applied to individual growth. And it's like, wow, we can really use this for a lot of things. Because quite often what happens is when you're a kid, they give you a piece of clay, they say make something, they give you an empty canvas, they say paint something, you can manifest your own destiny, be the change you want to see, right? It's all up to you, like all this beautiful stuff, but it doesn't quite cover the how. So how to steer that ancestral shift towards the light is what we're going to talk about today, right? This be the change you want to see in the world, everybody loves this quote because it's subjective. It can line up with you however you choose, whatever you see the change to be, you can be it however you want. So there's a lot of people that can resonate with this power of intention ideology, but we're going to walk through how to do that. Okay, so this is you being it. This is the change you want to see over here. So how to get from here to there. This is what the process we're going to cover. In the social services, they said notice, choose, act. Notice what's not working, or maybe sometimes what is working, just like in permaculture when you go out and observe and just like see what's going on. And then you choose a course of action, take action on it, right? This is a super simplified version of what we're going to cover. But if you just take this away today, that's great, because now you have some steps. Notice, choose, act, right? So today we're going to talk about purpose. Like I said, this could be a garden, this could be a bench shelter, this could be a website, this could be an intern program. This has been a number of these things I just mentioned. Project I did in Thailand, everything I did, we activated it with this design process. I've worked with a number of people in this room to help clarify what our intention is. So today we're going to talk about purpose. We're just going to use that as the example that we're going to walk through the process. That way it makes it more meaningful to you. But we'll toggle between purpose and garden. You'll see the correlation between those things, right? So if you have a pulse, you have a purpose. And the Blue Zone lady that was here earlier said that's one of the things that helps people live longer, is a sense of purpose, a reason to get out of bed in the morning, right? Finding that purpose is what's important to us. The reason for which something is done or created, for which something exists. What is your purpose? So if energy flows where attention goes, then how do we put energy towards finding that purpose? And this process is what we're gonna talk about. Mark Twain says the two most important days in your life is the day you're born and the day you find out why. And I would argue then the next day you find out why, then the next day you find out why, because from millennials to boomers, we're constantly like revisiting this, constantly like just tuning the chakra knobs to get in alignment with our purpose, why we're, what we're here for. So slowly trying to figure that out. Figuring out the why is a big deal, and we're going to talk about that a little bit today. We often talk about what we're going to do. We don't often talk about why we're going to get into our genetic core, some of our shadows and things like that, like what drives us. All right, so live on purpose is what we're shooting for. What does that look like? A simple version, help people, and your talent equals your purpose, right? This is the most simplified version there is. You can come up with your own version to find that purpose. Here's another one, find your gift and share your gift. That's your purpose in life. This person went so far as to go a little bit deeper into it. They said, if you find out what it is you love, what the world needs, what can you get paid for, create abundance for, and what you are great at, that's gonna give you your passion, mission, vocation, profession. So within that, you're gonna find your purpose. I would even argue your higher purpose, right? Not necessarily your vocation, your higher purpose. They all weave into each other, right? Your hobby and how you show up for your family, all that stuff is part of it. So it's not necessarily vocation. So how do I find my purpose? How do I manifest our vision, any vision? Take it from ideation to realization. I got 7 steps. The guy I told you about, the professor, gave me 15, and I added pictures and I made it simpler. So follow along, and I think you're gonna get some tools that you can glean from this to utilize in your everyday life, just sorting out what it is you're here to do, or like I said, creating anything. So statement of intention, idea generation, visualization, contextualization, presentation, specification, finalization. These words don't mean anything to you right now, but I assure you at the end, there's gonna be a special little tool within each of them that you're gonna be able to take away today. So we're gonna start with statement of intention. That is, notice and observe the situation, a lot like in permaculture. What's actually happening, free of judgment or opinion. Then identify what you discover to be the situation and list adjectives that describe your finding. Your core beliefs, needs, and values as they apply accordingly. If this is a permaculture situation, we may go into the soil food web. We may look at the patterns of nature, right? We're gonna observe it, and we're just gonna figure out what's going on, right? From that, we're gonna identify some things that are happening, and we're gonna create a statement of intention with all those adjectives, or a mission statement. The takeaway from this is a fuller understanding of the situation with a clear statement of intention, what is important to you and what you're needing. This can be a paragraph, an essay, as long as it stays true to your observation and avoids judgmental stories. We want to stay objective. The character we want to call in is curious and open, but objective and honest. All right, so know thyself, because we're not observing the soil in this situation, we're observing the individual. Know thyself. This is a simplified graph that shows 3 parts of the self, the IQ, the EQ, and the your personality. This is emotional intelligence and IQ, most people know. These are 3 ways that we can begin to identify aspects of ourself to understand our center of gravity. These 9 types of intelligence, and some people know musical intelligence, spatial intelligence, body kinesthetic intelligence, some of us have multiple intelligences. So in the IQ aspect, there's 9 of them. You wanna sort out who you are on that, get to know yourself. You know, like you take someone that has a kinesthetic intelligence and you put them in a position of analytics where they may scream because they feel claustrophobic. So you wanna know more about your type of intelligence so you can better understand yourself. So your emotional intelligence, there's 5 different types of those. There's probably more, but this is just one person's work. There's self-perceptive, interpersonal, decision-making, stress management, and self-expression. These are types of emotional intelligence. This is how you're gonna, generally, how you're going to relate to the world, the outer world and your interiors, right? This gives you some insights into who you are. Again, we're just trying to discover our purpose. There's the love languages. Some of you are familiar with those. If you're words of affirmation or gifts, knowing your love language, people around you love language, more and more awareness of the self. Lots of stuff to figure out about the self. All right, nature versus nurture, they talked about a long time. I don't know why it has to be a competition. That's just how we roll sometimes. It can be a cooperation. Nature is like past experiences, your cultural upbringing, family values, social influences. That's nurture. Nature is like qualities one was born with, maybe your cosmic imprint or your galactic chart or your astrological sign, like this is your imprint that you were born with, or you know, however you figure nature to be. Also maybe the aspects of being a middle child, things like that, that might develop, right? So your personality is made up of these things. So one way, super complicated way to figure this out that I've sort of got jazzed about over the years is Ken Wilber's work, Spiral Dynamics, Integral Institute, all this stuff, better understand yourself with lines, levels, states, and stages. right? That's a really heady way to do it. And then a simplified way is the medicine wheel, right? These are both North American ways. One's new, one's old, right? With this wheel, this is like an XY axis. And you sort of find out where's your center of gravity in this. And the reason they did that is not only know who they are so they can better relate to other people in that quadrant, but so they can begin to see where they're not, where their shadows are, where their growth edge is, so they can begin to pull themselves towards the center. Or, case B, they bring people into their sphere that pull them towards the center, right? So we work together to be a whole, right? So that's one of the main uses of understanding the archetypes of the personality, right? And so go back to the West and the Roman days, almost every god and goddess, even now in superheroes, there's like archetypes. In Smurfs, there's archetypes, right? Like, these are all ways that we relate to the world because we know people like this. So astrology taught us that these are like divine imprints that come from a long time ago that are in our DNA. You know, quantum mechanics said, discovered some correlations and came up with the Myers-Briggs based on your different personality types. So you can better, there's 16 in that system. And so you got the astrology map, and then Enneagram comes in, is a more recent development. It's not necessarily about your imprint of the time you were born, it's more about where you relate on this wheel. So depending on whether you're a fate or a destiny person, right? The idea is not to come into contact with your skepticism. The idea is to find ways to understand yourself, because, right, we're trying to figure out our purpose here. So you can't see this, but these are some of the archetypes in Enneagram. I'm an individualist here. It says I like to be authentic, but it also says that fear of having significance. This is why I'm up here in front of you, right? So there's parts that we understand about ourselves, and then there's parts that we need to know about ourselves. The shadow is super important if you're going to understand who you are, if you're going to create a statement of intention. So real quick, the I Ching on the eastern side of things, again, divine archetype in our genetic core coming through us. When people had time to look at the stars and talk to each other, they figured these things out, and this was passed along. The changing lines in the I Ching are very similar to correlations between the chakras. We find some correlations between the chakra and the Kabbalah. These are systems that existed for a long time to help us better understand who we are. The Kabbalah has some similarities to human design. Human design was then Richard Rudd just recently, in the last 10 years, really released Gene Keys, which is based on the 64 different aspects of the I Ching. Takes into account astrology, takes into account human design. It's an amazing system, Gene Keys. If you want to know more about yourself, I would recommend this one. Personally, I think it's just fascinating. You can go into a lot deeper. But the idea is, with understanding who you are and human, your archetypes and your characteristics, we can find that sometimes get lost in that rabbit hole, right? And so you're just, because it's super interesting and super curious, and just go and go and go in self-discovery. But what we're doing, if I put it in the context, we're trying to understand a little bit more about ourselves so we can write a statement of intention so we can activate ourselves. So come out of that rabbit hole and rejoin us, right? And put that service in action. Get to know all the characters in your head. What are your core values, and what are you needing? These are two basic ones. Your root, maybe your heart too, if you want to look into that, and your higher, you know, values, right? So one way we do that is in a group or alone, you sit down and write, just free write, my values. What's important to me? What's important to me? It's important to me that it's sustainable. It's important to me that it's authentic. It's important. It's your higher self. It's not this like, I want ice cream. It's like, it's important to me. You're on a soapbox now. Call in that higher self, right? Call in that your values. And then bring that down into your heart. Like, what do you feel? What are you needing? Bring that down into your core. What is it you want? Let that voice be heard. We don't often listen to it. They even throw a little tantrum with all these we want to get in character. Like, my name's Nico and I want it to be easy, right? And you just get into that character and just write those things down with your left hand if you want. And just play and get a big list of values and needs. Lots of adjectives. And what we're going to do with that is then begin to craft a paragraph or a few sentences and create a mission, a personal mission statement or a vision statement or something like that. It might be quite a bit longer than this. It might be a short story, you know, but it's going to help you better understand yourself. Now you know that, you know, authenticity is important to you. Now you know that sustainability is important. Now you know that it's powerful. Now you know that it's important that it's authentic, right? These kind of things. You know that about yourself. So you have a statement of intention. If you want to manifest something, you need a clear intention. Otherwise, you're just jerking around. This is super important part of the process. If you want to make a garden, it's important to me that it's abundant. It's important to me that it's beautiful. It's important to me that it's thriving. If you want to make a happy life for yourself, some of these things may also be part of it. That's why the garden is so cool. That statement of intention. Step one. See, that was a rabbit hole. I get excited about that one too. So these are the ones that are going to go faster. But see how the personal act, like getting to know yourself, can be enticing? All these cool systems out there. It's, you know, it'd be a shame if we didn't really activate one of them as a personal practice. We're going on to the next stage, idea generation, right? So the idea here is using specific techniques to explore your creative self fully, flush out your inner landscape, and birth the first steps towards your end goal without editing, questioning, or evaluating. This can be very divergent and expansive to allow for new insights to enter in. Divergent and expansive, right? The takeaways here are a fully expressed fractal map of your interiors with pictures and colors that represent, that resonate with your personality, including multiple interconnection and unanswered questions. The character we're calling here is like your inner playful self, your inner stoner self, like whatever it is, like, dude, we should do that, or how about that? Like, you know, this is super playful. Your adult self can come in later and like make the hard cuts like it does. This is a time to dream. We sit around and we dream together, or we do it individually. So ways to do that is come up with ideas. Where do they come from? Bill Mollison said the best design tool is a hammock, right? Be in a flow situation is a good way to do it, nice. Right? Let those insights come in. More than not, a good idea is accumulation of lots of others' ideas, lots of other people's ideas, right? We're all influencing each other. The noosphere is real, right? This is all interconnected. So it's not necessarily your idea, it's an idea that you had, and then you wanna like express that in its fullness. So some ways to do that is get into your right brain using your left hand or big crayons or your playful self somehow. Journal, free write, just let it out. No editing, go, 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 go. You got your statement intention right here on the wall, staring at you. Mission in life is to, oh my God. And so you're just go, go, go. I wanna do this, I wanna do that. And you express yourself with a brainstorm where you just write those things down in a free write, or a mind map. And a mind map is a super amazing tool that's been around for a long time. It takes into consideration how our brain is set up with nodes and synapses and pathways, and it's a fractal pattern where one good idea, you know, may spark another idea that sparks a bigger idea that links with someone else's idea. Next thing you know, this is a super sick idea because it's all connected, you know, through the neural pathways of your brain. And you lay that out on paper with a mind map, right? So this is like sort of inside your brain. This is you in the middle. This is aspects of you that are important. Your mind map can be super like detailed, right? You can go into super detail, make pictures, color, it's yours. It's expression of who you are. Your higher purpose is what we're trying to activate here, but it could be also your garden, right? It could be all the different, the pathways, the plants, the beds, everything, what's gonna be made out of. And you just free write, free write, free write. Don't edit, don't edit, don't edit. Let that self, dude, we should do this, how about that? You know, that energy, get it all out there. If it's not on your mind map, it's not gonna make it to the end process. You can do this with anything, B skills, anything that you need to activate, get all the information out of your head and with a mind map. This is a giant mind map. Each one of these is 4 foot by 4 foot. This is 6 different parts, a 12-week program we did for the Hive. So this is a super complicated, interrelated, cultural and community system that there's no way we could have done that in a brainstorm. It had to come out this way. It had to come out with each one in the middle, influencing another, and then we find connections, and then we can bring it into patterns and systems. There's also a computer version. There's many computer versions. I would argue if you want to save it for posterity or portfolio, then put it on a computer, but it does limit some of the playfulness, the free writing and expressiveness. But they're out there. We took the Hive one, we put it into the computer so we could save it. All right, so this is just here to tell me, when you're creating these things, when you're dreaming and idea generation, include your atmosphere and your music. The aromatherapy, jazz is super good for like being like expansive and creative because of all the playfulness in it. And then if you need to do some hard editing, you know, maybe some classical music or something like that. So whatever works for you, you know, like you generally without a lot of words or English words, at least if you're an English speaker, and you know, something that's going to get the old noggin going and in a playful state, right? Smoke a little, whatever you do, you know, relax. I mean, this is the time for that, you know. The coffee adult self comes later, trust me. All right, so that's step two. Step three, visualization, right? So the power of intention, people know all about visualization. This is super important, right? So the idea here is use your statement of intention and your mind map. You got two powerful magical symbols taped to your wall or on your computer. Use those two for inspiration. Begin to merge your ideas into visual form. Let images represent ideas without too much specification. Allow mood and feeling to be part of the expression. Let yourself feel into this idea now, right? Allow that heart to express itself. Don't want to specify so much that you pigeonhole yourself. Leave things a little vague. And I know for a lot of people that are doers, this is super hard, right? We're like, we're talking all around it. Let's get her done. But I guarantee we're doing this on paper. It's a heck of a lot cheaper. You think all around it before you activate it. And once you go for it, you're sure that you thought about it, right? So visual here, or the takeaway here, is a visual representation that communicates the fullness of your statement of intention and the expansiveness of your mind map with feeling and personality mixed in. Visualization. We've been doing this for a long time. The guys in, guys or women who created the cave paintings 10,000 years ago, they visualized the hunt. This is not just a slaughtered animal. This is a living animal with color and texture and excitement, right? They visualized it. They got into the state of it. And they know if they could visualize that, then they could activate it, right? The yantra, you can't see this. Yantras, mudras, mantras, these things are all great tools. We're sticking with visualization. So a yantra is a tool that it has a meaning to you, or a meaning that's been encoded in it. Some people use it with their meditation to call in abundance or whatever. This is a Shri yantra. And so I'm just contextualizing visualization. We've used these things for a long time. So these are sedules. This is on the other side of the path, Aleister Crowley's work, but I think it's worthwhile. So you take like a statement, like love thy neighbor, get rid of all the vowels, take the consonants, make a little picture out of it, tattoo it on your hand, put it on the wall. You see it every day. It's a magical symbol that tells you whatever you put into that. In fact, anything can be a magical symbol. It depends on just how you want to interpret it, right? So it can be vague like this. We do this a lot with our altars. A lot of people in this culture create little altars for themselves. They create things that matter, that have meaning to them, that they sit in front of, that help them call in certain things. We put pictures of gurus or people that have aspects of that we want to resonate more fully with, right? So we do this. We create our reality in a visual way. How to do it, if we want to take it back to the old school, no offense anyone, but if you got a bunch of crap stuff like this and stacks of magazines, I say go for it. That's how people used to do it. They used to create vision boards, and simple as easy as cutting out some words or meanings and pinning them up, or get crafty, cut it out, paste it up. These are mood boards, theme boards, vision boards, dream boards. Put a bunch of rainbows and dolphins in Hawaii. You look at it every day. Next thing you know, you're here. Voila, you did it. Through the power of intention from the visualization, right? This one's quite playful, and someone spent a lot of time making, so it doesn't have to be so literal. So nowadays we have Pinterest and we have the internet, so you can cruise around internet and you can just flag Pinterest stuff that you like and it'll put it right into your account and make a board, or you can get on Google Image. The idea here is you're finding things that represent aspects of yourself. Like if relaxation is what you want to call in, it might not be the words relaxation or someone sleeping. It might be like a candle and soft light, right? Like, or the color, a soft ambient orange or something, right? Like, so you want to find images that mean something to you, right? You can put them into Word, you can put them into Photoshop, you can just collect all your images and put them in a slideshow. That's the easiest way to do it probably. Put them in a folder, then slideshow that folder. And now, so I wanted to talk about the importance of creating the mood which you create your vision board and things like that. So I was like, workstation. I look up workstation. See, this guy's got two computers and a sick chair, and he's got a really good workstation. But it wasn't really what my intention was. And so then I was like, oh, maybe more like this workstation, right? I want to communicate to you, the audience, the importance of a workstation. But then I'm like, that's not really it either. Like, screw that whole idea, that old square way. That's what I'm talking about. It's like a hammock with candles. I want a workstation. I want to represent that feeling, right? It doesn't have to be so literal. So when you're making your vision board, find things that communicate to you, that have meaning to you. Put meaning into them if you have to. But have fun with that. That's really, here's even go further. Now I'm in a tub. I have not been any work done. but this is my where I went with that, right? And be playful with it. Pretend like you used to. Pretend you're this character when you're making this vision. This is me. I'm living in Hawaii. This is me. I'm self-actuated. This is me. I'm living my full potential. This is me happy. Get into that character. Live with that character. You have the statement of intention. You have the mind map. You have the vision board. Every day, take those in. Become one with those. And so you can, you know, like you used to, when you used to daydream, right? Like, I'm gonna build a rocket ship and go to the moon to get mangoes. That was a real dream of yours, probably at one point. And so this is the kind of energy you wanna get in. You wanna really create the vision of it, right? Use your mind for its highest potential there. So there is a program out there, you can't see on here very much. So you collect all your images, you send them off to this program called Mind Movies, and they take all your movies and they put them in a really beautiful 3 to 5 minute movie with words and cuts and all this stuff. I met a lady that made a mind movie like their dream board about living in Hawaii. She watched it 3 times a day for 8 months and she called this in, right? So this stuff is part of it, right? If you're getting closer and closer to actualizing your intention, you want to visualize mind movies. Okay. So next one, contextualization. The idea here, this is I think step 4, contextualization. Look around and discover what others are doing. Gain inspiration from their journey and realize how your unique expression is connected to the larger conversation. Contextualization. Check out possibilities and people who inspire you globally and locally. Then contact them. Reach out, build like a network of people that are rocking it how you want to rock it. People that maybe you come across with when you're making your vision board. You know, let them inspire you. The takeaway here is new inspirational influences and friends, hopefully, with a better understanding of how they got to where they are. Contact information, websites, books from organizations that you find to be exciting and motivational to push and support you, right? You're building a Rolodex, you're building a network, you're building your connection, your idea that you brought to visualization, you're now beginning to reach out into the world to see what other people are doing to manifest that. The mantra here is to find the others, right? This is the important part. And no matter how rare and unique you think you are, this is a butterfly, elephant, zebra, there, chances are there's other butterfly, elephant, zebras out there, right? So find the others. Right, so Barbara Marks Hubbard, beautiful, amazing woman, visionary, still rocking it, over 80. She created this wheel of co-creation. And so what she's suggesting here is there's a divine light that comes from the Big Bang that moves through everything and all of evolution. And here we are in this sacred space right here, right now. And these are ways, 12 ways, you can't see from there probably, but 12 ways or sectors that people generally find themselves in and how they express themselves. I know no one wants to be boxed in. That's why this is a circle, right? Chances are how you show up for the world or how you want to show up for the world is going to fit in. This is about contextualization. This is about finding the others. The Thrive people put it into a simplified version of that. So there's 12 sectors, health, infrastructure, justice, media, relations, and then there's an inner circle about different ways that you show up within these realms, and we'll talk about that. So find the others. You want to find out where you are at on that map, right? And so these are the categories: arts, economics, education, environment. You want to find out where your center of gravity is. What keeps you up is your fight. You're all old enough, you probably felt some intuition or some drive or some pull, separate than your parental push or obligation or any of that, right? You felt some intuitive knowing about your offering, right? And there might be 2 or 3 or 4 places, but for the purpose of this conversation, we want to pick 1 or 2 kind of things and we want to put our energy towards that. So when you find, you click on environment or education or something like that, the next thing you want to do is find out, this is the inner circle. Are you more of an immediate needs person, a systemic change person, or a consciousness shift person, worldview shift? So find out where you are on that outer ring, and then find out where you are in the inner ring. And you're going to find that there's 36 circles, and there's 36 groups of people like you with similar interests out there that you can contact and find, right? So immediate needs, direct action, we're all, you know, this is an energy a lot of us are used to. This is our activist energy. This is immediate needs, direct action. This is like teach a man to fish, right? Or no, give him a fish, not teach him a fish. This is like feed a homeless guy. This is like walk someone across the street. These are best practices. This is helpful, helping out, right? Feed a starving polar bear, I think is happening there. March in the streets. This is important, right? The direct action, civil disobedience. You can take that down whatever wormhole you want to. Direct action, some people would argue, is the only way forward. We don't have time for systemic change. We need direct action. And then some people would argue success isn't always an immediate change. If change isn't systemic, it isn't change at all, right? These are people in the systemic count, talking camps, talking smack about the immediate need camp, which is not necessary because we're all on the wheel together, right? And we all show up differently. What I find is when people that are relatively new in finding their purpose or discovering how they want to participate, they start with immediate action. They just want to do something. And after a while, they come up with some good ideas. They had some mentors, they had some teachers, and they want to work more on the systemic shift. Buckminster Fuller says, you never change something by fighting the existing reality. To change something, you build a new model that makes the existing model obsolete, right? That's a lot harder than marching in the streets. That's about creating whole systems that make the old systems obsolete. That's a lot of work. So this is one way to do it. So if we got the same old thinking, then we got the same old results. And we want to shift that vibration from the outer circle. I mean, if we're ready, no judgments, right? We want to shift from the outer circle to systemic circle, right? So still one of the 12 on the outer ring. This is about contextualization, finding the others. Everyone's with me? So we're shifting it into systemic change. Right, and one way that you're seeing people do that now is Planet People Profit, triple bottom line. They're taking business practices and they're making them more conscious. People and profit and the planet are being considered equally. That's a change. That's a change of a system, how we do business, things like that. So pathways to systemic change are hot right now because people are realizing there's a whole lot more that needs to be done, right? We really got a lot of ahead of us. So you can't see this. This is purpose, culture, stakeholders, and leadership, and it's conscious business. There's books out, sacred commerce, conscious business practices. Cafe Gratitude is a company that they have clearings in the morning. They're bringing conscious communication to their business practice. This systemic shift. If these get adopted, which we hope they do, more and more, our culture is going to begin to influence the wider world, right? So 3%, 5%, 100 monkeys, and everyone's following it, right? Because it's cool. All right, so we're shifting the vibration again. We went from immediate needs to systemic change, and now we're shifting into the middle. So when you're ready, you got a good system, you've activated, you've made some change. You might be an elder at this point, or you just might be really dialed in, like, Derek Jensen is a worldview shift guy that talks about immediate change, right? So this is a totally different way of looking at things. That looks freaky in those. All right, so it's a paradigm shift. And what we're gonna do is change from one way of thinking to another. That's a paradigm shift. This is major stuff. The hope is once we step into that, we don't step too far backwards. I'm not sure that's happening right now. We just gotta protect the progress. But paradigm shift is about busting down the walls, the old systems of oppression, all that stuff, right? It's about creating a new system, but it's more like the philosophy behind it. The 13 grandmothers are going around, you know, sharing wisdom. They're changing how people see, you know, the indigenous perspective. This kind of big picture stuff. And so it's not just about tearing stuff down; it's about building stuff up. So a paradigm shift is going to have different parts in it. So if you're on this outer ring of 12 parts, and you find yourself in worldview with environment or something, or with culture, you're going to do a festival like this, a transformative festival, right? This is part of maybe rituals and routines, stories and mythology, power structures. These are all things we need to build up and at the same time create a new paradigm. Symbols and artifacts, organizational structure, control structures, or no control structure, depends on your version of the paradigm shift, right? So it's also about tearing down, but it's also about building up. Finding the others, you can go on Thrive, I'll post this, or you can look at Barbara Marx Hubbard's work. Find out where you are on that. Chances are you're gonna be more able to align with other people that are vibrating similar to you. Right now we've gone through statement of intention, idea generation, visualization, contextualization. We have four powerful processes and tools that we've put together to get closer to our manifesting our intention. Remember the guy in the beginning, how do you get from here to there? We're halfway through that visioning right now. We have these all around us. What we want to do is share those. Presentate four polished portfolio pieces from your process. Streamline it to be able to communicate it to other people who you trust, will reflect back to you honestly, Revisit and integrate feedback accordingly. That last part is important. Revisit and integrate feedback accordingly. That's why you're doing it. So you want to be humble. The character here is proud and polished and like, and you want to present, but you also want to be humble and receive the offerings of the elders and the people that can help us better align with the bigger picture. The takeaway here is your complete package of information along with some authentic connections and support systems, hopefully some honest and poignant feedback regarding direction and completion of your project with newly illuminated aspect. So this is your offering, presenting it to get feedback, right? And it may look like this, depends on how much of a geek you are, or it may more look like this. Just this guy like getting it on the wall with a bunch of cardboard. Right? You present to elders, you're presenting it to a circle or a council, people that you trust. Like I said, maybe people that make you a little nervous, you know, that are gonna be really direct with you, cut through that. I went to art school and we appreciate people that didn't bullshit us, that gave it to us straight. You wanna find people that you're presenting all this stuff to that are gonna be like, that can read you and reflect back to you, mirror back to you how they interpret you. You can share this with your friends, you can create organizations and clubs, but when you do the final presentation, do it to those elders like I talked about. So the two big aspects here is staying integrity, right? Don't sugarcoat it, don't be too polished. Let them see the nuances of your face. Let them see when you stutter. Let them like reflect back to what they heard you say. Well, you didn't seem like you had a lot of energy for that part. I've known you for 20 years. I don't think that you're the kind of person that really wants to go that way. Let them give you that kind of grandma advice. And then are you teachable, right? Be teachable, open your mind, learn and grow. The more you listen, the more you know. Old ways don't open new doors. I could look at this every day. I need this medicine. Open to receive that. And so you presented it. You put all your stuff together, you presented it, you got some feedback, do the revisions as necessary, and now you can feel confident to go into the next stage, which is specification. Oh, no, I ran out of time. Specification, this is kind of the square bit, but some of us need this medicine, so listen up if you fell asleep. All right, time to make some organizational decisions. Use techniques to plan and address each stage of the development and set forth an agenda for activating the idea fully. Make and set goals if need be. If you're that kind of person, do that. If you're the kind of person that needs people to watch over you, invite them in. Say, hey, I'm starting this process. I'm trying to activate myself. And can you light a little fire in my ass every couple weeks? Can we get together? If you do it with other people, then you have that group, right? Specification. So we're going, the takeaway here is a concrete plan for activation, perhaps daily or weekly goals to achieve with a timeline, if necessary, right? A step-by-step list to achieve your desired purpose. Check-ins when your support system to stay on track. That's the circle I was talking about. So you can tell what world we're getting into. We're getting into like, time management, you know, there's lots of programs out there that can help you do this, that can keep you on track. You can put in your goals and you can set goals and they'll let you know. It's time management kind of stuff. But the technique that I want to give you is start with the end. This is reversed engineering or backwards planning. So the very end, you can vision because you have your statement of intention, you have your mind map, you have the contextualization, and you have the which one am I missing? Visualization. You have all these things in front of you and you have a good picture of what the end looks like. You can visualize that. Maybe you have a mind movie that shows you the end. Now, what happened right before that happened? And what happened right before that happened? And what happened right before that happened? Backwards engineer to where you are right now. Before this presentation happened, I set this up. Before I set this up, I pulled it out of the car. Before I pulled out of the car, I put it in the car. Before I put it in the car, I made sure I had everything. Before I left the house, I called my homeboy Robert and Stuart to come give me a hand, setting it up and doing the, like, you know, so I backwards engineer it, and then I have the whole, all the things that need to happen, and then what I do is I make sure that those goals are they specific, are they measurable, are they attainable, are they relevant, are they time-bound? This is all the stuff that, this is medicine we need, guys, right? This is, we need to check in with this part of the activation. The dreaming's beautiful, we need to take it, in my opinion, into the next level, and that means we have to be hard on ourselves and we have to set goals, right? And so set the goals, make the plan, get to work, blah blah blah, you get it. So this is a cool, it's called a life wheel, I think. It's a cool way to put your life purpose, business success, love life, social life, somehow you quantify and measure these things. It checks in with you. It reminds you. There's stuff like this. It's like a digital parent that, you know, kicks you in the butt to keep you going. So planning your project backwards can actually move it forward. So reverse engineering, backwards planning. This is the technique that I want to invite you to call in when it comes to this aspect of the process, which is specification. We're specifying. We're not visioning now. Now the adult's here. And now the adult says, get to work, right? So the last stage, thank you for making it through. The last stage is finalization. That comes at the end, obviously, and it has a shin, so it must be part of it, right? Bring it to fruition with regular progress on each stage of the process. Follow your plan until completion. Adjust accordingly, but stay focused and trust your process. Keep up motivation by regularly reviewing the entire project portfolio. You can go back and review it if you need to. You can make adjustments, but right now we're calling in that clear linear direction. The backwards engineer plan that you came up with that was birthed out of the presentation that you gave to people that was inspired by, I don't know if I've done this backwards, that was inspired by the visualization board and the statement of intention and the mind map, the idea generation, right? So now we're finalizing. The takeaway here is pride and ownership with a sense of accomplishment, what this feels like at the end. But this is a picture that sort of like, you can't see. It's a guy like self-actuated, just totally calling it in. This is me, I did it. We're celebrating, you know, we made a plan, right? But and we can change the world. There's a guy sitting in the lawn written on his shoe. And like that's kind of the problem. Is that the last part is people are doing a little parade a little bit early. So high five yourself, go out and celebrate. But you still got a lot of work to do. So you need to take step by step. You need to keep walking. You need to push yourself. I love this picture. It's like a little angel. You have everything you need to keep pushing yourself. There's a little woman like pushing herself, right? And so that's beautiful to me. Dream it, plan it, work it, make it happen. This is from the beginning. Be the change. Notice, choose, act. You know, if the seven steps don't stick for you, take this away. Notice, choose, act. We all know what it's like when people get stuck in the noticing. Complain and notice, right? So that's a beautiful part. The fingertips of the universe are noticing the challenges right now. People are noticing. But we need to bring that into direct action. We need to choose a course of a path, and we need to act on it. And the tools I think I gave you will help you better do that. So go back and revisit and review it, revamp it whenever you need to. You have the power to make that happen, and that's really the last bit of that is just believing that you can do it. A lot of us get stuck in this analysis paralysis. You know, in honor to Leonard Cohen and Serotonin, who sings a song, you know, there's like, forget your perfect offering, ring the bells that still can ring, you know, because there's a crack in everything. And it's like, and that's been my, that's been the frustration that I've seen, is that people want to manifest their intentions. They want to create their own reality. They might not have the tools, they might not have the skill set, they might not have the confidence. And I'm telling you, with these tools or tools like this, make your own list. This is not dogmatic, right? You can do something like this. So there's all the steps, and hopefully they have some meaning to you now. The statement of intention, idea generation, visualization, contextualization, presentation, specification, finalization. All right, and at the end, this is it says place image of fully actuated self here, right? So just vision what that looks like, and you're going to have a real good idea because of the process that you went through. Last thing, start where you are, use what you have, and do what you can. Just push through that. Just push through that, and just take steps. This is a fun process. This is not meant to be stressful. This is meant to engage you, and these are techniques that you can use in your everyday life. So I'm going to close. My name's Nico. I'm going to close with this mind movie here. I don't know if you can see it. This is like one on love or gratitude. It doesn't matter. Here you go. And so I run Lower Puna Rising. I help people take anything from idealization to realization, whether it's self-actualization or it's a business or anything like that. So you can contact me and reach out if you need a little help or fire or, you know, someone to give you a hand around that. So thanks for listening. I know that was a lot of information. Thank you.